evening. Please don't immediately yell into the fire.
I was far enough away. Welcome
to the Spooky Boys Spooky
Podcast.
How do I stop this? All right, there we go. Welcome to the Spooky Boys Spooky Halloween Special Spooktacular
Extravaganza.
End of October scary episode.
It's gonna be a real
creep.
It's gonna be as creepy as this mustache on my face.
Your costume was great.
It was fantastic.
Your costume is wonderful.
So, to start things off.
Also, welcome back to the Third Opinion Podcast and Radio Show. Mondays at 2, Fridays at 5. We're on episode 12, and we're recording this one October 29th.
If we want to get technical, though, mm-hmm. It's episode 13.
Well, technically.
If we want to be technically.
Yeah, technically, the ghost episode.
It is the 13th episode we have recorded.
We have recorded 13 episodes.
It is the 12th episode.
Number 12.
That has existed.
Yes.
On air for your ears.
Yeah. But there have been 13 episodes.
There have.
One of them was just a ghost episode. A Gus episode. One of them was a Gus episode.
Oh, boy. So.
We're going to tell you guys some spooky stories.
We're going to have a good time here.
Fun and spooky
stories.
This
is a good introduction to the Halloween times.
Uh-huh.
Going to play the day right before. That way you can chill yourself with some spookiness.
Some spookiness.
Spooky boo.
Some spooky boys episodes.
I have a few stories here. You have
a few stories here. Mine are mostly Russian-based because of my adoration for Russia.
For your...
And also...
Tracksuit.
My Adidas
tracksuit.
Yeah. Me and Andrew, our costume went great. I'm going to post some pictures of the party on... Twitter and Instagram and Facebook and
absolutely.
All that.
It's going to be a good
so,
time.
Also, Sophia says she might get us some social media going for the podcast.
Ooh.
So we'll see how that goes. But you can just follow me at EMH Games on just about everything.
You can follow me whenever I choose to remember my Twitter.
I don't think you have Instagram either.
No, I don't gram.
You know,
I cracker. I gram cracker, but I don't gram. Instamat gram. So. But yeah. Party was a great time.
It was a fun time.
Had a real big success. We've talked about it a little bit on here at this mm-hmm. point. Just a little bit.
Just a little bit. Maybe, not spoiling
maybe,
too much.
Maybe a lot of bit. We've talked about it quite a bit. But yeah, we had so much
on the podcast though.
You know, we had the PUBG.
Yeah. Player Unknown's Battlegrounds, a video game. It's in the style of the Hunger Games and Battle Royale.
It was a lot of fun. Big nerf gun. Fighting.
It was a lot of fun.
Foam flinging fun. It was fantastic.
It was a great time.
Thanks for asking.
You're welcome for asking.
Get that fly out of here.
Hold on. Let me go ahead and. So, on the last episode, my mom got us a duck horn.
It's still here.
And I've been aggravating Andrew with it all week. He's gonna be one of the next guests.
It's still here
on the radio show and the program, and I did the funny bit where it was like,
"What? Where's that fly? Somebody, get that fly! Get that fly! Got it! Ah!"
And it was so funny because he's like, that is so loud. It's so much louder than an actual
it
fly.
It really is. It's so obnoxious. You were doing it all last night. I was like, dude, but I was like, do it again. Do it again.
Oh, you also said our friend Hunter. It was a venturing Halloween party.
It was a good time.
And my friend Hunter, he dressed up as a 1920s bank robber gangster.
He was.
And he had a...
He had quite the impressive costume.
His costume was great. He always does great costumes. For 2015, he did Slash.
Thoroughly impressed.
He looked... Impressed.
Impressed.
He looked just like Slash for 2015. There's pictures on Facebook and stuff. I'll find them. But he looked just like Slash.
Yeah.
He rolled up to the party, and I went as Big Boss. And I was like... Who invited Slash? He looked just like him.
Right.
Like it was ridiculous. But he had a rubber band Tommy gun. And you said...
I really wanted to shoot it.
I wish we had rubber bands.
I wish we had rubber bands. But it's semi-automatic, though.
Yeah. Which, you know, can't really help it.
It is what it is.
But you said... get him to shoot the Tommy gun and make the sound for the duck horn, because I always bring the duck horn everywhere I go. And he said to make it sound like a machine gun shooting. And I said, okay. So he held up the Tommy gun, and then he started making the motions that he was shooting, and it went,
all right, I'm going to let him have it. So funny.
Everybody loved it. It was just
such
about
such a good bit.
Andrew didn't really. Andrew thought it was funny, but he didn't like it as much because I've been aggravating him with it for a week straight.
That's because his entire life has been the duck horn.
Yeah, I talk to him all the time on.
Oh boy.
On the internet.
Oh boy, no escape. All right. Fasten your seatbelts, ladies and gentlemen.
Keep your arms and ears inside the.
Your chairs or wherever you're sitting or standing. Or jogging, or however you're listening to this.
You're going to get spooked.
It's going to be scary.
All right, go ahead, Ethan.
All right. This one comes from a little fella by the name of Edgar Allan Poe. Fortunato had hurt me 1,000 times, and I had suffered quietly, but then I learned that he laughed at my proud name, Montressor. The name of an old and honored family, I promised myself that I would make him pay for this, that I would have revenge.
Ooh, revenge stories. Revenge stories are always great.
I must not suffer as a result of taking my revenge. A wrong is not what made right in that matter. And also the wrong would not be made right unless Fortunato knew that he was paying and knew who was forcing him to pay. I gave Fortunato no cause to doubt me. I continued to smile in his face, and he did not understand that I was now smiling at the thought of what I had planned for him. At the thought of revenge. Fortunato was a strong man, a man to be feared. But he had one great weakness.
What was that?
A man befouled by the drink.
Ah, a drunkard 'tis he.
A drunkard he 'twas. One evening, when it was almost dark in the spring, I met him in the street alone. He spoke to me more warmly than he usually was, for already he had drunk some wine. Fortunato, how are you? I shook his hand. Montressor, good evening, my friend. My dear Fortunato, I am indeed glad that I have met you. I was thinking of you. I have been tasting a new wine. I have bought a full cask of wine, for which they tell me is Amontillado. But Amontillado? Quite impossible. A rare wine indeed. Where do you have this wine? Where do we go to taste it? To your vaults? To taste the wine? No, my friend. No, I can see that you are not well, and the vaults are cold and wet. I do not care. Let us go. I'm well enough. The cold has nothing. Amontillado. I must have the Amontillado. This man was quite drinking with his drink, as we can tell.
As we can tell. Sounds like he has nothing else better to do at this time.
Nothing else. Asking for him to be careful as he followed me, I went down before him, down, 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 deep under the old walls of my palace. We came to the bottom of the steps. The floor was cold and hard. We entered the last resting place of the dead of the Montressor family. Here, too, we keep our finest wine. Fortunato's step was not sure because of the wine he had already been drinking. He looked uncertainly around him, trying to see through the thick darkness which pushed in around us. Here, our brightly burning lights seemed weak indeed, but our eyes soon became used to the darkness. We could see the bones of the dead lying in large piles along the walls. The stones of the walls were wet and cold. Here, Fortunato. Here, drink some of this Medoc. It will help to keep us warm. Drink! Thank you, my friend. I drink to the dead who lie sleeping around us. And I, Fortunato, drink to your long life. Ah, a very fine wine indeed. But what of the Amontillado? Your vaults are many and large. There seems to be no end to them. We are a great family, and an old one. It is not far now. We went on deeper and deeper into the earth. Finally, we arrived in a vault in which the air was so old and heavy that our lights almost died. Against three of the walls, there were piles of bones higher than our heads. From the fourth wall, someone had pulled down all the bones, and they were spread all around us on the ground.
Oh, no.
In the middle of the wall, there was an opening into another vault. If I could call it that. A room a little more than about 3 feet wide, 6 or 7 feet high, and perhaps 4 feet deep. Go on, I said. Go on in. The Amontillado is in there.
Oh, no.
Fortunato continued to go forward, uncertainly. I followed him immediately. Soon, of course, he had reached the back wall. He stood there a moment, facing the wall, surprised, and wondered, is that a wall? Were two... In that wall were two heavy iron rings. A short chain was hanging from one of those, and a lock from the other. Before Fortunato could guess what was happening, I closed the lock and chained him tightly to the wall. I stepped back. Fortunato, I said, put your hand against the wall. You must feel how the water runs over it. Once more I ask you, will you not go back? No. If not, then I must leave you. But first, I must do everything I can for you. But the Amontillado. Ah, yes. The Amontillado.
He's still fixated on this wine. He's about to be killed.
As I spoke these words, I began to reach among the bones. Throwing them to one side, I found the stones which earlier I had taken down from the wall. Quickly, I began to build the wall again, covering the hole where Fortunato stood trembling. Montressor, what are you doing? I continued working. I could hear him pulling at the chain, shaking it wildly.
Clink, 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 clink.
Only a few stones remained to put in their place. Montressor, it was a very good joke indeed. Many times we will laugh about this as we drink our wine together. Of course. As we drink the Amontillado. But is it not late? Should we not be going back? They will be expecting us. Let us go. Yes, let us go. As I said this, I lifted the last stone from the ground.
Oh, no.
Montressor, for the love of God. Yes, for the love of God. I heard no answer. Fortunato, I cried. Fortunato! I heard only a soft, low sound, a half cry of fear. My heart grew sick. It must have been for the cold. I hurried to force the last stone into its position. I put the old bones back in a pile against the wall. For half a century now, no human hand has touched them. May you rest in peace.
What? He just killed him? That was good.
Spooky story.
That was good.
It's like a favorite of mine. I enjoy that one. First read that one in English in high school. It's a good one.
It's a good story.
All right, boy. Spook me.
Are you spooked yet?
I wet myself. I'm so scared.
Oh, okay. So mine isn't so much a spooky story as mine are just like spooky tales and folklore and all that. This one is called The Buzzer. And it is, I get this from their website, mranker.com. But I've heard the story, you know, just around on the internet and all that. And this is a real thing, too. Like a lot of these, like, oh, it's just a spooky story or folklore or whatever. But you can actually hear this one or whatever. It's a creepy tale about a Russian radio station nicknamed the Buzzer that has been broadcasting and letting out a buzz about every other second since the 1970s. Every few months, the buzzing is suddenly interrupted with a voice saying UVB76, followed by a series of numbers and code words. Then the buzzing starts up again for a few more months. And nobody, since it began in the 1970s, has figured out what any of it means. Like, no one has any idea what it is. And the Russian government's like, we don't know what it is.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, like, it's really spooky. And that people think that it's like, well, it's a military communication method that's, like, debunked or whatever. It's be a countermeasure, like, for nuclear war or whatever it is.
So it's just something that plays over the radio?
Over the radio in Russia, yeah.
Huh.
Yeah, like, it's really hashtag spoopy. Let me find the thing. Let me find the audio on YouTube real fast. Ah, jeez. Here's what it sounds like. Like, it sounds like that, and it just plays 24... Like, it has not stopped since the 1970s.
That's really weird.
That's really spoopy.
Yeah, that's...
Let me find...
That's pretty creepy. It's stuff like that that just...
Yeah.
That just makes you wonder, like, somebody's...
I have goosebumps right now, yeah, dude.
Yeah, but at the same time, I'm just like, man, somebody's got too much time on their hands.
You know what it is? It's about it.
It's clearly just you.
It's me?
with a horn. In Russia. recreated for you live.
It's not me.
No, that is scary.
It's though. Really... But the thing crazy. Is called UVB76. Because they have the radio stations number different across the United States and across the world. And, you know, it's a real one. It's real. And it's really, really spooky. So if you haven't heard of that before, now, you're welcome. Have fun sleeping tonight.
Hashtag you won't.
Hashtag you won't. Man, I got the heebie-jeebies. This is the worst Halloween ever. I'm so spooked.
Stay woke.
Stay woke, people.
You gotta stop that. You gotta stop that.
That fly came back.
Oh, boy.
Yeah!
Oh, boy.
That was spooky. I'm going to close that before I get spooked again.
Don't want that noise going on.
Yeah. There's another good one that happened before the Chernobyl disaster, which, you know, I'm sure people that are listening, like, live through a lot of that.
Right.
My mom remembers a lot of that.
Yeah.
And apparently there were, like, a lot of creepy circumstances before the actual meltdown of Pripyat and Chernobyl and all that. According to some of the survivors that left the place, that left the cities and all that, they said that they, like, were experiencing, like, nightmares of, like, everyone dying or whatever.
Not weird.
Like, weird phone calls, which phones, you know, had been around for a while and whenever it happened.
Thanks, Alexander.
Thanks, Alexander Phone Bell.
Alexander, Graham Cracker Bell.
Graham Cracker Bell. And, apparently there was a huge winged beast that became known as the Black Bird of Chernobyl. So it's kind of like Man-Bat in the DC comics.
Right, right.
But like black. Like black as the night.
Yeah.
And apparently it was like larger than a human. It was a winged creature like a bat that was the shape of a man, but had bat wings.
Man-Bat.
And it had like dark glowing red eyes. And apparently someone said that they saw it flying like by one of the reactors whenever it was melting down.
Nosferatu.
Probably. I don't know. Dude, I'm spooked. I don't think I want to do this anymore. apparently, also, people said that they are quick to relate it to the apparent harbinger of death of the legendary Mothman in West Virginia, which started showing up before the Silver Bridge collapse. So people say
I've heard that one.
Yeah, yeah. People say they're like they're very, very similar in description. And there's something funny at the end of this paragraph. It says, "So if you see one, turn around and go home." It's like, well, yeah. What am I gonna do? Not turn around and go home? Go talk to it?
Sorry, time to die.
So in Arkham Knight, quick sidetrack in Arkham Knight, Batman Arkham Knight, the last video game in the Arkham trilogy, the Arkham series, Man-Bat. You encounter randomly, and like the bat appears out of nowhere, and like scares you to death.
Yeah, it scared me to death.
The bat appeared out of nowhere, and then Batman is like, "Oh, well, I gotta defeat this now." And I'm over here like I'm like clutching my heart, like, "Oh, where'd this thing come from?"
No.
Batman, we don't need to chase.
It's not time for this.
An actual bat.
This is supernatural and spooky.
It was scared me because it like appears out of nowhere. And I was like, ha! Like really loud too. But
oh boy,
yeah. Hold on a second. Okay, Google. Turn on office light.
Okay.
It got too spooky in here, dude. I'm turning the desk light back.
Turn those lights back on.
Turn the lights back on. It got too spooky for me.
Gotta turn down the spook.
Russia will do that. The Russian
folks. They've got a lot of crazy stuff. That's like the Jersey Devil. You heard of that one?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That one's bananas.
Have you heard of the Chupacabra? That one's a classic one.
Blood-sucking goat eater.
Yeah. That one's pretty spooky.
That is a good one.
All right, you get another story for us?
I do.
Mm-hmm. He says as he puts the phone down.
This really happened. Okay.
Okay.
So I was driving home one night. The fog was thick. It was rolling in, creeping across the land. I drove my car to the only gas station on the highway there. I realized I was low on gas and short on time, so it was now or be faced being stuck in the dark.
Yeah.
Which no one wants to do.
No. Uh-uh.
Especially when I don't carry a flashlight anymore.
Yeah, for real.
From there, I pulled into the gas station. Started filling up with gas. The lights began to flicker.
Oh, no.
As I walked into the store.
Was this before you pay with like a debit card or whatever?
Yeah, I only had cash on me at the time.
Oh, no.
I asked the cash register guy. I said, "How much?" He says, 15. 52. I looked in my wallet. And there it was. Exact change. It was actually really convenient.
That was really funny.
Hope that one got you.
That one spooked me really good. There was, here's a real spooky story that happened to me in real life. Twice. So in the big house where my mom and sisters live now, where I used to live for a couple years. In the big Chupacabra house. Our step-grandfather, he died New Year's Eve, 2009. Mm-hmm. Real story. This isn't a joke. 2009, New Year's Eve, he died. I think his throat... I have to ask my mom again. But like, you know, he was like 78 or whatever. It was, you know, like suddenly also.
Right.
Absolutely horrible. But I think a few days after the funeral and all that, after he died in the funeral and everything was done, mm-hmm. I heard like a deep moaning sound from the back of the house that we were not supposed to go to because, you know, he collected guns and knives and
right.
like, you know, toy cars from like the 1940s and 50s and all that. And we're like, don't go back there. Don't touch anything. So me and my sisters were always like, I wonder if there's like something spooky back there. And I've had weird dreams about the house also. So we never went back there. Right. But a few days after the funeral and all that, like I heard I don't want to recreate the sound because it's going to spook me even more than I'm already spooked.
Got to turn on the lights.
I literally was like, all right, I'm leaving. I'm going outside. And I waited for my grandma to come back outside. She didn't hear it. It was just me that heard it.
That's crazy.
But it was a really loud, like deep moan. But get this. That's the first time. Like 2010, like mid-January probably. Right. Only one to hear it. I told my grandma, she's like, you're making stuff up. I'm like, okay. Okay, you say so.
I'm sorry.
Let's see. We moved into the house mid-2014. I think May 2014. So probably early 2015. Or it would have been like summer of 2015, I think.
Okay.
Summer of 2014, summer of 2015, yeah. Around that time. I get the years confused. I've done so much. Me and my mom are like getting stuff to go outside to go swim with my dad and my sister because we have a pool in the back,
right.
In the backyard. It's an in-ground pool, you know. It's summer. You want to go outside until the summer. We were getting something. We were talking. And I hear the deep, loud moan again.
Oh, no.
And my mom said, did you just hear that? I said, you heard it too? And she said, all right. Do you know who that sounded like? And I said, yes, I know who that sounded like. I'm so glad you heard that. We went outside and asked my dad and my sister, did you hear anything? They said, no, we haven't heard anything. What took you guys so long to get back outside? So me and my mom are the only two to have ever heard that. And we think it's our step-grandfather.
It's super spooky.
It's really spooky. And I've heard the sound twice. And standing in the same place. And my mom was the only other person to stand with me the second time around. Yeah, I'm like, no thanks. And what's crazy is like, she sleeps in that room now.
Oh, jeez.
And she hasn't heard it since then.
Oh, jeez.
So, like, so what is it? Like, my dad said, well, it's probably the air conditioner. And someone said, no. Air conditioners don't sound like that.
No, Dad, no.
I wish I could remember what the thing sounds like so I could, like, try to recreate it. But, like, I can hear it in my head, but I don't know, like, how to make this sound. I'll have to ask my mom. If you see my mom in person, you have to ask her about it. She'd be like, oh, yeah, it was really spooky.
It was real.
But yeah, that's a real ghost story
for me. That is one. Yeah, that's
wild.
Ghost
story I've had happen to me. I have another one. When I was a kid.
I remember one I had, but I can't remember it now.
Whenever I was a kid, I used to watch a bunch of, like, scary stuff to keep myself out. Yeah. As you do. You don't know any better. And I watched an alien show about, like, this girl being abducted by aliens or whatever. Right. And, late one night, I would have been 5 or 6, probably. And,
like.
Okay, and we're back.
We had a bit of a spectral interference.
The laptop ran out of space.
No, spectral interference.
Because I cheaped out and bought a cheap
spectral
laptop.
Spectral interference.
The ghosts didn't want us to finish the podcast.
Yes, that's how creepy this episode is.
Yeah.
The ghost episode is back to haunt us.
He's back, dude. Oh, no. The last thing we need is the ghost episode to come back.
Yeah, we don't. It was bad.
Yeah, that was hand from someone that did not want us to make that episode.
It was the ghost of the ghost episode.
Yeah.
Spectral interference.
Yeah. Well, either way, I was going to finish that spooky story, but, you know.
It's all great.
We're also almost out of time.
We are. So on that note.
Hope you got spooked.
A little spooked.
I got the heebie-jeebies now. This is the worst Halloween ever. I'm so spooked.
Goosebumps.
Good time. I'll post all the pictures and stuff on Instagram.
Absolutely.
Twitter and all that. So follow me on Twitter at EMH Games, on Instagram at EMH Games.
And follow Elisha on Twitter at EMH Games. Because I can't remember my Twitter.
Yeah, ever. we'll have Sophia upload all the episodes as much as possible. And they're on YouTube as the Third Opinion Podcast. And you can listen to all of them.
Go subscribble
to it.
You won't regret it.
You won't regret it.
You get to relive the same fun twice.
You get to listen to the same garbage show more than once.
All right, folks.
Wait, that's not on the Google Home.
All right, folks.
There we go.
We thank you.
Thank you
and
so
we
much,
bid folks. You.
I do. See you guys on the next episode of the Third Opinion Podcast. Money's at 2, fries at 5, and we spooked ya.
Goodbye.